This is Tracks FM, and it's time for Face to Face with your host, Terrence Duss, speaking to this week's panelist. Face to Face, every Wednesday, 5:15 till 6 p.m., exclusively on Tracks FM.
Welcome to Face to Face, the largest live conversation on national radio. And this evening, I have a very special guest with me. He is Tan Sri Razali Ismail, famed globalist, and of course, one of the most senior people you think of when you think of international relations. He is now the chairman of SUHAKAM, the brand new chairman of the Human Rights Commission of Malaysia, and we are pleased to really have him here to speak to us on his new position. How are you doing today?
I am fine. I thank you very much for wanting to come and talk to me. I know how wide you cast your net. The transmission goes to a lot of people who are interested in it, and I'm very honored that you have come to interview SUHAKAM. But what you are going to get from me is actually is my response to things, and a lot of it will be my own views.
Right.
I'm entitled as a human being, as a Malaysian patriot, to have my own views, and I do not think this in any way would disqualify me from being chairman of SUHAKAM.
Tan Sri, how has the position changed, you think, since Tun Musa Hitam first took up the chairmanship to your current position? Is there any difference in what you were trying to achieve now compared to what SUHAKAM set out to do then?
Well, that was 16 years ago. And whoever was the first chairman. But you shouldn't look at these things just as the chairman and his 8-9 cohorts, you know. It should be like a collective effort. Mm-hmm. This is why the government has thought it fit to get people from East Malaysia. They have a different point of view, perhaps a different way of looking at things. And the closer to the ground, there are aspects of deprivation or marginalization, where people have lost their traditional claims to land and all that, and that also features in them. So these people have contributed. But coming back to your question, I think the young people of this country, justifiably, are more and more alert and more demanding that the government acquit itself well on issues relating to human rights. Mm-hmm. And as we have come a long way, as a country advancing in a certain way, and as we have come, we have accrued more respect from the world for all the things we have done and our involvement in so many issues all over the world, we cannot but be also accountable to human rights principles. And this, and if it happened 16 years ago, we were quieter. Now, 16 years hence, from now, we would be obliged to be clear in what we stand for. But it is not enough just to bang the drums on human rights. It is important that now, after 16 years, we begin to actually roll up our sleeves and do something about human rights in terms of operationalizing human rights in Malaysia. Mm-hmm. At the beginning. Mm-hmm.
But what can SUHAKAM do? Can you just sort of walk us through some of your powers and your jurisdictions when it comes to human rights issues in Malaysia?
The Act have allowed us to promote awareness of human rights through education. The Act has opened us the door to advise and assist the government in formulating laws and policies relating to human rights that have effect on human rights. And the Act have also allowed us to recommend strongly to the government, accession to international treaties relating to human rights. And the Act has allowed us to take into account, to allow people to come to complain to us about their loss of human rights or infringements on their human rights. Mm-hmm. So that's a big, big field. And really, if we can work realistically and comprehensively, we can be quite successful, I think.
Well, let's look at this retrospectively on a statement by the former chairman, who said that SUHAKAM was a little worse than a toothless tiger, a very tired watchdog. These are statements which he made, and they're in the Malay Mail, 2015.
Well, you know, chairman of responsible bodies sensitive to public demands and public complaints. I mean, there's an up and down. So in your bad moments, perhaps, in your down moments, you just become dejected. I don't think Tan Sri Hazmi would consider the years, the 6-7 years that he spent in SUHAKAM as completely noir, black. There have been some important accomplishments in the time of Tan Sri Hazmi.
Let's look at some of your own recent statements, Tan Sri. The current state of human rights in the country was unsatisfactory, and after 16 years of its existence, SUHAKAM's files are full with records of unending meetings with paltry and of protracted expectations, if not promises. Do enlighten us on your approach in resolving these issues.
Well, you know, this is the first time, this is the day that I was inducted as chairman, and the first statement I was making, I thought, let's get a bit of drama. But it is real. We cannot stay as we are. That is tokenism. That is not accepted. The young people of this country will never accept that. And they will show, they will feel less in terms of being a Malaysian if we do not adhere to human rights principles. So I had to say these things in order to wake us up and also to give a wake-up call to the institution of SUHAKAM itself. Mm. It has to do better than before.
Let's look at your newly appointed commissioners. What can we expect from this lineup?
Well, I don't want to be looking down the road too far, but they're giving very good support and they really are showing that they have expertise in various fields.
And do you think this enhances SUHAKAM's credibility in the eyes of the young Malaysians that you were speaking about?
Yes, there are a mixed bunch of people, not just lawyers or academicians. There's the guy that was an NGO, is an NGO. There are people who came from that kind of persuasion. Mm-hmm. And I am the generalist. I don't know as much as they do, but I think I can put things together. I would try to play the role of a synthesis maker. There are so many views, and we present to the government, and we try to make it as palatable to the government as possible. And these 7 people that are with me, mm-hmm. they will be able to help me, definitely. Mm-hmm. And they have their ears and on the ground to how people feel about how we perform. Mm-hmm. Which is why in a statement after that, I mentioned that reporters, journalists can come and check up with me every 3 months what I've done or what the situation the SUHAKAM has done or not done.
The annual report that SUHAKAM presents to Parliament, how much weight does it carry? Because you did say strongly advise the government, and these are still words which carry with it an advisory role. How much of an impact does this annual report actually have on the laws of the land?
Well, obviously it has not made any impact if they do not want to look at it in a parliamentary setting. That is a big disappointment. Mm. I'm sure if we can talk to the right people, persuade the right minister, the 2 speakers, talk to the members of parliament, that they're actually cutting their own nose, as it were, you know, because it's embarrassing parliament itself mm-hmm. and the country. So that we will have a better, I hope, we will have a better response from parliament next year at our next annual report.
We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we will be back in conversation with Tan Sri Razali. So don't go anywhere. Face to Face resumes after this short break.
Face to Face will be back right after this. Stay tuned to find out more on today's topic, exclusively on Trax FM.
We're back on Face to Face. Hope you enjoyed that tune, pre-selected by Tan Sri himself. Let's get back into the gist of our conversation. Tan Sri, Suhakam, moving forward. We left it on the note of the advisory role of Suhakam and its annual report. And you did say earlier that we hope that Parliament will take this more seriously. Speaking to the right ministers, talking to the Speaker, bringing the annual report to surface during a parliamentary session is one way of going about it. But there's this huge democratization of information. The people are making their voices heard. They have Twitter, they have Facebook, they have all kinds of social media platforms. Do you think that these voices calling for change, calling for more pertinent human rights actions or human rights related laws will be heard?
Whenever are the efforts of the people, the legitimate efforts of the people are, and whatever would be what SUHAKAM doing, they have to gel together. SUHAKAM is not just representing them. SUHAKAM is amalgamating the voice of the people and putting it out to the government. So this word advice in the political context means more than advice. This organization is not an it has not only an advisory role, but its advice has to be taken seriously by the government, because it is not 8 commissioners working together and giving advice. It is all of us and all of the people possibly adding to the advice. So it is advice that has to be heeded. So I think somewhere down the road we should have to talk to the some people in the government to make them understand what advice here means.
And also looking at that wide plethora of voices available on the ground, do you think that there should be an effort to get them more organized so that they can join in your own efforts and you can uniformly advise?
I have begun, SUHAKAM has begun to discuss with various relevant bodies, people who have the expertise, who have knowledge on the ground, like Malaysian Youth Council, bodies like that, to see whether we can join efforts. Not just catch the attention of the government and say what would be needed, but also to teach certain aspects of human rights to people. We cannot do it ourselves, SUHAKAM, completely. So we have to get bodies like that to do it, and we're going to do that. So again, I'm coming back to the fact that we are trying to combine efforts, to converge our attempt to broad-base democracy and human rights in such a way that the government will have no option but to take our advice.
Tan Sri, since we already started talking about it, let's look at your plans moving forward. You have a 3-year chairmanship tenure and then possibly a renewal, as historically has been done. 6 years, what are your plans for SUHAKAM? How do you see this body moving forward?
Let's talk of 3 years. Give me my present for the 80th birthday, for 3 years from now, to finish it all in 3 years. First statement I made, I talk about the unfinished stuff,
right,
the post meetings after meeting. We have to get product coming out of that. We have to look back where we have left it with the government. We must push and cajole for the government to come to decisions. If they say they cannot do it, then they should have the ability to say they cannot do it. I don't want us to be taken for a ride. Mm-hmm. That's very important, because everybody's listening. People want us. People do not, especially a lot of people do not expect us to succeed. You know, I don't want after 3 years to come to certain very pessimistic conclusions. I think this country has a fantastic future. We are so diverse and we are so dedicated to make this country work, and human rights must be part of it.
Tan Sri, after more than 35 years with the Malaysian Diplomatic Service, you've seen the world. You've been a Malaysian looking from a global perspective onto our country, and now being back home looking outward on the global scenario. Do you feel we are lagging behind regionally in terms of human rights enforcements, in terms of human rights infrastructure?
The whole region is lagging behind. I mean, we have an ASEAN vision, ASEAN set of principles. This year is supposed to be a people's ASEAN, people-oriented. But what have we really done? I mean, there's supposed to be a people's assembly. That also didn't get off the ground. Political leaders shouldn't go for headlinings. I mean, they really must mean something. Historians, people in the universities, record all this thing they say. And there are bodies internationally that also will analyze the things that they say. And they will come to the conclusion that ASEAN is a talk shop where human rights are concerned. There are so many marginalized people in ASEAN. Various communities have been deprived of their rights. Why are we not doing anything about it? And we are starting so wonderfully. Because we nowhere in anywhere, not even in Europe, can 10 like-minded countries of different persuasions politically, but like-minded, having the same goal, get together as often as ASEAN. And surely we can give better results to the people. Mm-hmm. And not just the people, the environment, which also is part of human rights.
Mm-hmm. What can a person whose human rights are infringed upon hope to achieve when he or she comes to SUHAKAM with a complaint?
There are a lot of complaints that have been, people come through the door and ask, and we take all this. And we try, some of those things, unfortunately, are sort of historical. And historical things you cannot deal, if the train has left the station, as it were, mm-hmm. you cannot bring it back. But there are so many grievances, justified grievances, we must look at. But let us look at working together for the principles that are important, then talk in terms of specific grievances. That is one department, but the other one is how do we operationalize these principles so that Malaysians do not have to demonstrate because they think our democracy has not gone far enough, our election system has not gone far enough, correctly enough. So we don't have to do that. Why? Why is it necessary for people to demonstrate? They will not do it if they are happy with the situations.
Tan Sri, do you feel that the entire country knows about human rights? Every single Malaysian, do they understand what human rights means?
I do not think so. And part of the fault is SUHAKAM. We have not been able to be effective enough all on the ground. We have not explained. If it's up to me, I would like to bring it to the children, especially in the rural areas, to explain to them why it is important to have human rights. When in the digital world, somebody in the village can find out the price of how a coconut or something are sold, similar coconuts are sold in another part of the world, and she will know the price of it. Given that knowledge, she can make sure that she's not cheated by the middleman and all that. Mm. So that is human rights. Mm-hmm. It is important that you empower people this way. Mm-hmm. This is what I think Malaysians deserve to have.
Some would say that we need to define human rights to reflect our own culture,
yes,
our own religious nuances and our own Asian values. But most of the human rights treaties we've signed, in fact all 9 of them, are broad-based and global in nature. They probably do not take into account our own religious sensitivities, our own Asian nuance. What's your take on this?
That is true. I can understand that very well. But that doesn't mean this should be a problem towards us acceding to those treaties. The treaties allow for exceptions to be made, qualifications. So we should do that. We should indicate that we want to do this. This is the highest point we want to go to. But there are certain conditions which we have to look at. The treaties allow for that. It is no longer possible for the government of Malaysia to use this as a reason. Whether it is this religion or that religion or Islam, we cannot use this as a reason. We can make qualifications.
Well, Tan Sri, you did mention about the slashing of funds to SUHAKAM, which just might emasculate its mission slightly. Will you be able to function effectively if you work on a skeleton budget?
The secretary of SUHAKAM doesn't think we can function if we don't get enough funds. By November, we would have to reduce drastically our operations. Mm-hmm. And the guys here will not be paid their salary, and that's not allowed. I'm sure the government is going to come around. I don't think we should be too worried about it. There will be money. Mm-hmm. But we cannot say we cannot work if there's no funds. We should work even if there are not enough funds, because these guys are all very committed. They are dedicated to the work. That's how I see it. But if things really go bad, I will appeal to all the citizens of Malaysia who love SUHAKAM to give a dollar at a time. If each of them gives a dollar, I can function very well. Mm-hmm.
Let's hope it does not come to that. But a dollar, I think, is minimal. Most Malaysians who know about what SUHAKAM has been done.
Yeah, so we'll definitely give more than $3.
I think we can convince them to give 10.
Yeah.
So I think so. Listeners, I know you're out there. You're most definitely going to be one of those people who sign up for 10. How reachable is SUHAKAM to the general public? How do they communicate with you? Is there a portal? Is there a website? Is there a Twitter handle?
The portal, the website, but nothing beats going on the ground. No shows. Go down to some parts of Perlis or some part of somewhere like that. Let people know what we are and how important we are to their status in life.
Mm-hmm. Are there marginalized communities that you are targeting to work with? Or to help empower, or are you going at it as an entire process that you're going to go into in one fold?
Yeah, we will work with the marginalized community. Of course, the marginalized community will be, as you mentioned, our B40 people there. And the marginalized community also include women who have not been given empowerment, mm-hmm. have been beaten up by their husbands or whatever and all that. So that has got to be done too. There are so many things to deal.
Exactly.
But to me, I start with the children. I think if at the age of primary school, they already know there is such an organization that really underlines my right as a human being and my right as a Malaysian. And that's wonderful. This is what we should do. But at the same time, we don't forget grievances of people of various communities. We have to deal with that too. But we are not a super-duper overarching organization. We can only do something if we get the support of all the other relevant bodies and the government.
Kids won't be asking their parents to change their names if they're unhappy now that they know they have the
change
right to
change their name.
If they're not happy with their name, can they complain to SUHAKAM, say, you know, my dad gave me a lousy name, yeah. Ultraman Bane Batman, can I change my name?
That is within your right, isn't
that
it?
That is within our
rights. You're not 21 and above, isn't it?
Exactly, so, I am. So it is within your right to change your name. Tan Sri, you stated your mission. What is your vision for SUHAKAM? How big or how much more relevant do you aim to be?
Let us look at some countries outside, how they have done it. Countries like us, which have had to deal with other things that come its way, adversity, loss of price of commodities, emergence of serious terrorism, and diverse communities making all sorts of demands, various religions that are not quite fitting in nicely as one would have wished. So there's all these things that have to be looked at. SUHAKAM will have to be part and party of all those aspects to bring solutions to that. Sure.
It seems you have a lot on your plate. Do you have enough manpower to do all of this?
No. This is why we must enlist the support of the people. I'm quite prepared to farm out some things that I do here. I don't have to do research on the attributes of this or that. I can give it to a university. Mm-hmm. Or I can give it to an NGO group that can do these things. Why do I have to do it? I don't want to. I believe in what they have got. So.
Have any institutions of higher learning come forward to say that they would like to be part of SUHAKAM?
Not part of SUHAKAM.
Part of your research.
We stay intact as we are. Mm-hmm. I don't think that allows us to incorporate or co-op, but they will work with us. Mm-hmm. Yes, there have been many. Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of individuals out there with the noble gesture of being the one-man NGO. What do you say to people like these who trumpet their cause, sometimes a little bit too loud, sometimes all alone, they go at it alone. Should they galvanize and
I do not believe about one NGO taking care of everything.
The
government is supposed to take care of everything. I don't think an NGO, because NGOs don't have the kind of accountability that governments have to deal with. If you look at financing, some NGOs, the accountability is less than you desire it to be. So NGOs should be very good in what they want to do. If they are doing advocacy or doing things on the ground, they must be very good in that. Mm-hmm. You can't mix about. The best NGO I've come through, I don't know whether they're NGO, is Medicine Sans Frontier, Medicine Without Borders. That is wonderful. I've seen them on the ground in Kenya and everywhere, in refugee areas, where they've done really good work. mm-hmm. and some of them have died for that.
Looking at your vision, the mission you've laid out, and also some of the shortcomings, what are some of the international best practices in your own experience that we are lacking here in Malaysia that would help make your mission and help achieve your vision in the near future?
We have opened our doors towards internationalism, international activism, and we've done quite well. We are in Geneva, we're in New York, we take part in so many things. We're in OIC, ASEAN, and in all these areas we've been in the forefront of change, constructive change. Having arrived to a certain point, I think countries like us in ASEAN have begin to look slightly inwards. Other than the money, the finance that we need to grow our economy, other than that, we tend to think that we have done a good job and we can take care of ourselves. Maybe that smacks off the fact that we have a very strong history, so we can be confident about doing things. Like if you go to the EPU, the EPU has done a damn good job. Mm-hmm. So they really do not have to take lessons from the UN. So that kind of attitude translate into many civil servants not wanting to take into account too many things that are happening outside. And leads finally to that situation where we think we can do it. We don't have to listen too much to it.
Isn't it called Malaysia Boleh?
Malaysia Boleh. There's a limit to Malaysia Boleh. You're so right, yes.
What if we could remove this all-encompassing, negative twist on the Malaysia Boleh attitude and accept some of those best practices? What should we put in place?
There are so many things that we can put in place. There are so many, I said somewhere, closet human rights who really are human rights, but they are in the government and they don't think they should make too much noise about it. Mm-hmm. But there are so many people who will really come out and embrace human rights. And it will benefit the villages, the towns, the various communities and everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Finally, Tan Sri, a message from you to the listeners out there who are, of course, the humans who are possibly looking at SUHAKAM as a body that will give them all the tools they need to solve all the human rights issues that they face on a daily basis. What do you say to these people who are looking towards SUHAKAM for answers, for resolutions and for solutions?
I think all of us are on the road towards improving ourselves. I think if we can think collectively and we are serious about wanting to go to advance in terms of principles, and then you should look at an organization like SUHAKAM and give it its full support.
And to the powers that be, the people in power, the ones who have the ability to move forward with the human rights agenda, what are your hopes for them?
It is not hope, it is expectation now. We want them to help us to change the country. And constructive change is not anything to be feared.
Thank you, Tan Sri, for your time. It has been truly a pleasure speaking to you once again. And I hope our listeners have really enjoyed this, a rare opportunity to be in conversation with one of Malaysia's most seasoned diplomats. Thank you so much, Tan Sri.
Thank you. And if they have any comments, I would receive them, positively or negatively, no problem.
That's all the time we have today on Face to Face. We'll be back next week with our host speaking to the panelists about today's current issues. Join us next week, Face to Face every Wednesday, 5:15 till 6 p.m., exclusively on Trax FM.